Pastor Nazarene, you got a lot of plans for today. It's going to be exciting. Good morning. Good morning, Larry. Larry, glad to be here, buddy. Glad we're all here. Will you stand with us?
You may be seated. We're going to do a small set change. If you will, we're going to have some kids come and share some Christmas story with us. And as they are preparing to do that and some stuff is happening back here, I just want to welcome you to Pastor of Nazarene. And I wonder if you would just pray with me. Would you do that? Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you so much for the time that has come right now to come to your house, to gather in fellowship with one another, and to worship you with songs and sacrifices of thanksgiving and praise and offering. We pray, God, that in everything that is said and done today in this service, you would be pleased, that you would be blessed, because all glory is due you. We love you, and we thank you for loving us and sending your son, Jesus. We pray all this in his name. Amen.
We had an exciting time there. Kids did great, and I've seen some grandpas and parents that were all looking pretty proud of out there in the first place. And then the second thing I was thinking of was just baptism in general. And I always love it when we have a baptism. And, of course, again, you have family around that's celebrating that baptism for their child. And then the next thing that happens in our services that we have had is that the pastor asks us to stand up. And who are we going to support as these kids grow up and also become young Christians and adults in their life? And I always feel like grandparents and parents always have the right to be proud of what they do. But we as a church are also proud to see our kids grow up and affect society, affect us in our church life and our Christian life. So we can also be proud of what our kids are doing there. So again, great job, everyone. Leadership on that too. Tanisha, I bet you Stacy, Lacey, okay. So give them a warm hand as well. So every year we get to find out just what a great and loving church that we have. And we know that if you still missed it and want to give more to the pastor and staff, we send out a letter that just reminds people that we want to do something for them for Christmas time. So, the first person I would like to make sure that comes up is Rich. Where is Rich?
Christmas.
gotten a great pastor this last year. So we just want to say thank you for all that you've done. You've turned into this, well, you were a great leader when you came to us, but we've begun to know you. Maybe that's a problem in itself, but we've begun to know you and love you and appreciate your guidance, your leadership, and your shepherding for us here at Pasco Nazarene. So make sure that that gets to Tanisha first before it. Okay. So anyway, everyone, give a warm hand.
If the ushers are prepared to receive God's tithe and our offering this morning, and as they come to do that, would you bow your heads and pray with me a blessing on this, our sacrifice of worship. Father God, we come before you to offer our tithe. You have asked and commanded us to do this, so we come with a humble heart and a cheerful heart, and we bring our first fruits and place them in your hands, God, and we pray that your will would be done with them. We pray that in doing this, God, you would reveal yourself in a very powerful way. Your word says you will. And so we pray that your will be done here at Pasco across this great nation and all over this world. Multiply this tithe in ways that are not humanly possible, God. We give it to you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask the kids to come down front, sit down in the front row. We have another story about that this week. How are you doing, Zane? You did a good job as a shepherd up there. I learned some things about your guys' performance. You want to know what I learned while you were up there singing? You guys taught me. I learned that sometimes shepherds look like Jedi. Sometimes they do, especially when Star Wars has just come out, right? And I learned that Mary, man, she had a hard time keeping that covering on her head. Why did we even have that? If it's going to fall down all the time, why did they wear that? I don't know. These are things I got to go find out. We are talking about Advent. Does anybody know what the word for today is? The word for today's candle? Michaela! Joy. All right, so I need somebody to light that first purple candle. Does anybody remember what we light the first purple candle for? What's the word? Isaac, you remember the word? No. Say hope. Hope. Don't light the greenery. No, first one. So we lit 2 weeks ago the candle of hope. And it's the prophecy candle, we call it, the prophets of old that talked about the coming Messiah and the hope that Jesus brings. Almost there. There it is. Woo-hoo! Owen, can you come light our second candle? Who remembers what our second candle was? Isaac, you had it first time.
Love.
Love, right? It's that candle of love. Because when God sent Jesus to us, it was because he loved us so much, right? John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And today we get to light the third candle. It's the pink candle. Okay, not the white candle. That's not till Christmas. But it is the pink candle. Anybody want to guess what the pink candle is when Caleb already said? Do you remember? Penny, do you remember? You don't remember? Joy. We also call this the shepherd's candle, because what happened when the shepherds saw that angel? The angels, when they came down to them in that starry night, said, "We have come with good news of great joy." I need somebody to come light the joy candle. Is anyone good? Have you lit a candle already?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Isaac, you want to light it? I'll help you. I'll help you. Okay, I'll help you. I'm going to help you. Hold on to this thing.
All right, there we go.
You got it, good job. Now, I just said the people, there are some people that knew that joy, what joy was right away, and they were the shepherds. After visiting the stable, when the angels came and told them about baby Jesus, after visiting the stable, they went back to their sheep. They were glorifying and praising God. But a lot of people living in Bethlehem missed it. Did you know that?
No.
What were they doing when they missed it? They slept right through the night. What happened in the middle of the night? They missed it. They slept right through the whole thing and they never knew it happened. We light the candle on the third Sunday of Advent to remind us that the angel said, we have good news and great joy. Philippians chapter 4, verse 4 through 7 says this, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That sounds like good news, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. We have a little bit of joy to share today, don't we? You guys sang about it. We have a little bit of joy. We call it the Holy Spirit. It's Jesus in us, right? And we can take it wherever we go and bring joy to other people. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this candle that we celebrate today. And it is reminding us of the joy that comes in Jesus Christ. God, we know that there's lots of material things that bring us happiness, but that happiness quickly fades often. And we know, God, that your joy does not. It does not require situations or happiness or material stuff. It is a gift freely given by you. We thank you for that this time of year and all the year through. Thank you for the joy of Jesus. And we pray this in his name, amen. All right, kids, you can head back to your seats, and you get to hang out with us this morning. Are you excited about that? Zane, are you excited to hang out and hear a sermon? I better wow your socks off, huh? I want to share with you this morning about joy, but this focus in Advent that he is light. We've been talking about he is coming, he is Lord, and he is light. And that light gives us great joy, doesn't it? When you're in the midst of darkness, and someone brings some light into the situation, it kind of brightens your day, doesn't it? Doesn't it?
Amen.
Yes. Okay. You're not all sleeping. In every generation, there's a relationship between light and hope. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
That when light comes into darkness, there's hope. Hope of something new. Hope of an end. A light at the end of the tunnel. So to speak. For the weary sailor who'd been lost at sea for days, a glimpse of a light on a rock, a lighthouse, would show them where they were, and there is hope in that. For a young child who wakes up suddenly from a nightmare, fearing what might be under the bed or in the closet, when you turn the light on, and all those monsters go away, right? Now it's just a sweatshirt or the cat. It's amazing what cats can do in the dark, and they make it seem like there's monsters. They can make noises, glide all over you, and if your imagination is running wild as a kid, boy, that fur might just be a beast coming to get you. Now, in many religious traditions and worship settings, the simple act of lighting a candle, these three candles right here, can symbolize divine presence and life. We only have to read the third verse of Genesis to see how significant the foundational role of light is in creation. It says, "And God said, let there be light, and there was light." That's pretty cool stuff. Let there be light, and there is light. No more darkness. By its very nature, light can guide us, lead us, help us, give us life, and show us truth. The first century Roman world knew what it was like to be guided by the light. In evening, when the fire burned down and slowly turned to ash, the town became quite dark. We don't have this problem anymore, do we? If you are in the midst of a wheat field on the Palouse, and there are no buildings in sight, you know what darkness looks like in the middle of the night. As soon as you crest a hill and see a city, you don't see a collection of dark buildings. You see lights everywhere, right? We populate this earth with a lot of light, and we burn through a lot of electricity. Sometimes that light is bringing hope. When the sun rises, a new day begins. Light in the absence of light determines the rhythm and the tempo of life from the beginning of time all the way up to now. I'm going to read this out of the Gospel of John, chapter 1. It says this, starting in verse 6. It helps if I turn this on. Probably. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. We're kind of like that witness, aren't we? Much like John the Baptist, we are proclaiming a way, proclaiming that the light has come and will come again. You ever, as a kid, sit in your bedroom at night after your parents have turned off your light, and then eventually when they go to bed, they turn off the hall light, the bathroom light, and it gets darker and darker, and your imagination just runs wild? Anybody ever do that? Any of you still do that? Maybe if you've had one of those weeks at work, and your mind is just racing and racing and racing, and you can't turn it off, and you can't stop thinking about stuff, and it's dark in your house, and it's really quiet, and all of a sudden you hear a thump, and your wife hits you. What was that? I don't know, maybe your husband hits you and says, "What was that?" Maybe your cat woke you up and said, "Meow." Something out there. And you know the proverbial next thought is what? Go figure out what it is. I want to tell my wife every time, "You're the one who heard it. You go figure out what it is. I'm sleeping." But you know, as you start walking out the bedroom and down the hall and it's dark, I don't know why in every TV show, every movie, and even in my own life, there I am walking through my house in the dark, not turning any lights on. I wonder what that noise was. When all it really takes is to start turning on some lights to reveal situations. Some of us, we're not too sharp sometimes. Especially when we're running from sleep. And sometimes in that darkness, our own minds run wild with what the possibilities could be of what was in the dark. How has darkness brought fear to your life? Or how does darkness bring fear to your life right now? Somebody just share with us. How has or does darkness bring fear into your life?
Unknown.
Unknown. Ooh, that's a good one. Anybody afraid of the future? And I don't mean like trembling with fear, but you know, just caught up in thinking about what's going to happen. You know, the what ifs, the unknown. Is it going to be good? Is it going to be bad? Am I going to win on that scratch ticket? Am I going to pick the Powerball number? Or when you go to the doctor, as in our, and I'm saying our advanced years, brings more and more trepidation as we wait for results from that doctor's appointment, wondering what is going to happen, if anything, unknown. Something else. How has or does fear bring darkness bring fear to your life?
Alone.
Being alone? Yeah. I'm not even gonna expand on that. We all want somebody, right? I said I wasn't gonna expand on that. Being alone, oh my goodness. And not having someone to be there for us in our times of trial or in our times of mountaintop experience. Somebody else, how has darkness, or how does darkness right now bring fear? And you can substitute that fear word for worry, trepidation, or any of those things. Somebody else. None of you are suffering with darkness right now, I can tell.
It can bring doubt.
Or fear of
it. It can bring doubt into your life.
It can bring doubt. That's a baby too. And then the what ifs multiply, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then magnify. Because if we have unknown in our life, and we have doubt about our future, and the positive things, just like darkness, sounds can get amplified. Things can appear that aren't what they are when there's light shining on them. That can terrify us. We can begin to doubt ourselves. Advent and darkness go hand in hand. We talked about this a little bit last week. Darkness and light are imagery that we find familiar. Not just because of our experience with physical darkness and a light switch, or physical darkness and a candle or an oil lamp, but for so many other things. Because of our experiences with emotional and spiritual darkness, because of our experiences of loss or grief, because of depression, we can end up feeling like darkness is covering everything. There is no light. There is no hope. There is nothing but darkness and suffering. Violence. Death. And then what we would oftentimes classify as darkness itself, sin, creep in. We often think of holiness or righteousness as white and sin as black or darkness, right? Jesus is light. Those who are not found in Jesus are in a great darkness. And Jesus brings light, not at the end of a tunnel, but to the darkness. Are you glad about that this morning?
Amen.
That Jesus takes his light and comes to you, where you're at, and he scares the monsters away. Advent is a time when we reflect on the coming light, a light that entered into our darkness to illuminate the heaviness, the grief, and the pain. And in a sense, to do what I just said, to chase monsters away, to take our fears and cast them out, to shine light and truth on everything that may be misunderstood or misinterpreted. Light's come, and it's Jesus. He does this exceptionally well. He chases monsters away better than anything in the universe. And wherever he goes, there is no darkness. He is light.
Amen.
And life. Advent Advent is a time when we reflect on that coming light, and it's also a time that we shine hope and life and grace and love and joy into hearts and minds, into our world. We take that light of Jesus and we reflect it like a mirror, the image of God, into a dark world, into a place with scary monsters. A light we often need to be reminded of in the midst of our darkness and pain, and a light we often need to shine for others in their darkness and pain, that they might see hope in the midst of that darkness. This promise of light coming is what John came to share with the people, John the Baptist. This promise of a coming light and hope, it was his purpose. John was a messenger. People confused him with the Messiah, but he was a messenger. He assures people of the Messiah's coming. He said last week that he himself, not very Messiah-ish, wearing camel hair clothes, eating grasshoppers and honey. And he even went to the extent to say, I'm not even worthy to tie the sandals of the Messiah. I have come to help prepare the way. John uses the imagery of Jesus as the light. The people knew darkness. We talked about this last week. We talked about how they hadn't heard from God in a very long time. There had been no prophets for centuries. We talked about the oppression that they were under. Roman rule. Anybody like having rules over you that you don't agree with? Some of you are saying, oh yeah, I don't mind that. You're all liars. None of us like having rules over us that we don't agree with. And I would say the vast majority of us don't particularly like having rules over us that we do agree with. We just don't like somebody on top of us telling us, hey, you got to do it this way. We don't like being told what to do. We want to be free. We want to be rebels down underneath, right? They knew what darkness was. They knew what suffering was. Brutal suffering, persecution as people in their own land with a foreign government over them and a foreign army persecuting them. These people walked in darkness, not just because their city didn't have electric lights. They walked in darkness of despair and grief and suffering and pain, emotional pain, spiritual suffering. They felt like they were in the desert. And I think today we would all say, well, that sounds pretty familiar. We know what suffering is too. We know what darkness is too. We spend a lot of time praying to God those words that David said in the Psalms. How long, Lord, must we wait? How long must we suffer? How long must we be in persecution? Would you just come and make it all right? Would you come and lift us out of this? We need Messiah. Think we need a Messiah today?
Amen.
The good news is we got one already. His name's Jesus.
Come on now.
He already came. So why do we still suffer in darkness as if he hasn't come yet? We know darkness. But folks, we also know light. It's Jesus. We lose our hope sometimes. We get off track. We get distracted. We sometimes think God isn't being very faithful. accomplishing what he's promised us. We've all had those times. Some of us are going through them right now. God, this is not the rose field that I thought it was going to be. Tiptoeing through the tulips. This should be a life of ease. Because I'm a follower of Jesus, right? It's supposed to be rainbows and unicorns. But I tell you what, that's living light and light. And Jesus says, I need you to take my light to the dark. I need you to go and make disciples. That means go into dark places. That means taking a light into a place filled with monsters. That means going to a place that we aren't comfortable with. It means getting out of buildings like this. Getting out of the street. And in the homes of people that we don't much care for. Maybe they're that neighbor that stole our tools. Borrowed. 2 years ago and never returned. That neighbor that you're always getting in fights with because they play their music too loud or this or that, you know. Or a co-worker, man, that you just rub the wrong way every day at work. Jesus says, would you be light? Would you bring hope into that situation? Would you bring love into that situation? Would you bring joy into that situation? Would you be me in that situation? Because the light has come, and the light is Jesus. The promise of Advent, even though it's already happened, it's been fulfilled 2,000 years ago when that little baby was born in that manger. But Advent isn't a one-time event.
Well, no.
Advent is the preparation. Prepare the way of the Lord. It is remembering that it has happened and will happen again. Are you ready? Are you ready for Jesus to walk into this room and say it's time? I think 99% of us would say, no way, Pastor. I'm too busy. Ready for what? Ready for Jesus. Ready for him to set foot on this earth. To reign as king for the rest of eternity. Well, you say, well, Pastor, I got shopping to do. It's Christmas. You know, my wife and I have been saying, well, we're putting on a dinner for the church board and all their families and stuff. And we got a lot of shopping to do, and that's tomorrow. So I got that on my checklist. I got to go to the grocery store with the wife and push the cart around. And if you haven't found all your Christmas presents yet, it's getting here quick. Maybe you're like me and you wait till December 23rd and you wonder where all the stuff is in the store. How am I supposed to go get it when it's not here? But in the midst of all this, Jesus is coming. And Jesus is Lord. We like the pretty picture of Jesus being Savior. And we really struggle with the picture of him being Master and Lord, telling us what to do. He saved us. And I don't have to do anything. Paul says, all I've got to do is believe. I believe. And I do. You want me to do what, Jesus? You gotta be kidding me. Can't talk to those people. Those people. Help us to live each day in hope. That's Jesus. Expectation of the kingdom of God at work in our world right now. The day of the Lord is here. And it is coming. John told the people that the light they had been waiting for was coming. I'm telling you, folks, the light has been here, it is here, and it's coming again. John's message meant that the people could have hope and could anticipate an end to darkness. Are you anticipating an end to all the garbage we're going through right now? Are you? Or are you resolved that there's just nothing in this world you can do about it and you're just going to wallow in suffering? Jesus is the light. We've been told and we believe that the light has come. Luke chapter 2, verse 8 and 10 says, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby." The kids read this today. What better Christmas program is there than reading out of God's Word? You can have the flashiest script and all the comedy and all those great music and all those things, but when you put God's Word in front of people, there's nothing better. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. Can you imagine? They're watching over the flocks at night. It's the night crew, the graveyard shift. And they're not even in the town. They're out in the fields. And it's pitch black dark. Moon and stars, the only light. Probably a campfire, which ruins your night vision. And then all of a sudden, brighter than bright, light from heaven. And it's angels, and they're talking to you. The glory of the Lord shone around them. Wise men followed the light of that same star. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 says, "After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, 'Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him.'" We saw a light in the sky. It's a light unlike we have ever seen. And we decided to follow it. Prophecy has been fulfilled. We're here. Where is he? We've come to see the light. Today we have hope and we anticipate the end of darkness. Folks, this perspective changes everything. We can either anticipate the end of the United States of America because of political things going on that we don't agree with, or we can anticipate the end of darkness because Jesus is coming. We can focus on anticipating more evil, more mass shootings, more political strife, more world events, people with nuclear weapons that we don't want them to have nuclear weapons, okay? Wars and rumors of wars. Or we can anticipate the coming of Jesus, who will put all this to an end. We have hope, and we anticipate the end of darkness. Today, we don't need to live in darkness because the light has already come to live in us, Jesus, and through us to other people. John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus says this himself. He spoke to the people again, saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me won't walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Now, I want to tell you today, if you are a follower of Jesus, you said, "Jesus, I believe you came and you died on the cross to save me from my sins. I am seeking to do the very best I can to follow after you, God, to do what Jesus says." If you call yourself a Christian, you won't walk in darkness, but you have the light of life. This is amazing stuff, folks. You say, "But Pastor, I'm in this dark time of my life." Yeah, Jesus, right? Let Jesus bring some light into that dark time in your life. Let Jesus illuminate it and change your perspective. As a follower of Jesus, whoever follows me won't walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. When the scriptures refer to Jesus as light, the symbolism and imagery are incredibly powerful. I want to leave you with these as we go. As light, Jesus desires to lead and to guide us into truth. If you want to know what's true in the universe and the world today, read some scripture, follow after Jesus. Now, I will stand up here and I will tell you that we as pastors are completely and utterly fallible. We ought not to speak for God. We tell God, would you speak through us? And we do our very best. But even us, even we as leaders in the church, have trouble sometimes discerning truth. We go to the Holy Spirit and say, would you enlighten our way? If you think the pastor has all the answers, he may have trouble. God's the one that's got the answers.
Amen.
God is truth. I do my very best. But Jesus wants to lead and guide us into truth. This is one of those master times. Sometimes he wants to lead us and say, you know, come on over here. He's going to be a good shepherd. And sometimes he takes that crook and wraps it around your neck and says, get him over here. Right?
Amen.
Because you've been stubborn and you've been going to the direction they don't want you to go. As the light, Jesus calls us to listen and to follow him. He says, we're sheep. And we are. We're stinky and smelly and stubborn and sometimes we've got to cut our hairs. It's a good analogy. Sometimes we aren't that smart.
We have no
But Jesus point. Also says that the sheep know the shepherd's voice. And they listen to it. And they follow after it. Know the voice of the master, of the shepherd. Listen to him and follow him. As the light, Jesus desires to expose and expel any darkness that might reside within us. We would call that sin. Because no darkness can survive where the light is, right? Some scientists would tell you darkness isn't even a thing. Because darkness can't overcome light. If there was enough darkness, you'd think that it could overcome light. But there isn't enough darkness, it's not really a thing. But light. Light overcomes darkness. And as the light, Jesus desires to expose and expel the darkness from your life. Whether that be psychological pain, emotional pain, or sufferings. Sin, just outright rebellious behavior, you know. Any of these darkness things, Jesus wants to get those out. Because he wants you to have the fullness of life. And as the light, Jesus desires to birth new life in us. A new creation of original and unique design. God's design. He wants to expose and expel all that darkness, and he wants to show you exactly what he designed you to be. A new creation. I sometimes struggle with folks who know who Jesus is. They've been baptized. They're walking the walk. They're talking the talk. But they still label themselves as what they once were. I'm an addict. I'm an abuser. I'm all these things. No, no, no. Jesus says, you are a new creation. New, brand new. Spotless, white as snow. You don't have to be in darkness anymore. The light has come. You're a new creation. How about we have a new label. I'm a follower of Christ. I'm going to live that out. We don't need to live in despair because we know that Jesus came to earth to live among us in our darkness. If you could just take one thing home today, it is this. The light comes to where you are. The light doesn't wait for us to achieve some lofty goal and get to the standard of the light before he'll say, I'll help you. The light comes to the darkness. Jesus came to earth. He taught us. He transforms us with his light and his love. He is the light for our path so that we have hope. He is the light of our path so that we can share love. And he is the source of our joy. Would you stand and let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this time of Advent. And even though we are moving through these discussions, talking about darkness and suffering and the relationship it has with Advent and anticipation and preparation, we thank you for your light, Jesus Christ. We pray today, God, that you would help us to have the courage to allow you to do these things that you want to do in us, to lead and guide us to your truth. God, make your truth perfectly clear to us. God, would you help us to listen for your quiet voice and to follow after you? And here's a biggie, God. We need you to expose and expel the darkness that is in us. We confess, God. We need that. We need both Savior and Master. God, would you bring to the surface the dark things that are in our life? We don't even realize that they're there. And by the power of your blood, by the power of your Holy Spirit, God, as we seek forgiveness with a repentant heart, would you wash us white as snow, a new creation designed for your holy purpose. In that, God, we pray that you would create new life in us. As David, a man after your heart, once said, God, create in us a new clean and purified heart. As we come closer to this holiday, God, would you awaken an anticipation in us that we would share your hope, your love, be so filled with your joy that it just oozes out of us, God, and spreads everywhere we go. Now we pray your blessing upon us would be, God, that we would let you put action to our hands and our feet, our mouths, our minds, and our hearts as we leave this sanctuary, this sacred place, and go out into this dark world, God. Shine your light brightly on us that we would reflect you and all these good things so that all will know that there is a God and he loves us. Bless us as we go, God. We pray this in your wonderful and holy name. Amen.